So we welcome you to this first online meeting of the Populism Study Circle. It is an initiative of the Political Science Department of the Aristotle University of Thessaloniki. It is really good to meet you all here via Zoom platform, and we hope soon to have the opportunity to meet again lively. We have to say that this meeting is the first that will be held in English, and in the following 90 minutes, we'll try to discuss with our guest speaker, author and historian Thomas Frank, about the anti-populism discourse in the United States and the American presidency elections 2020. After the speech of Thomas Frank, we'll follow an intervention by Professor Yannis Stavrakakis, and then the floor will pass to the members of the Populism Study Circle and the audience for questions, comments, notes, etc. For the warming up of the floor is now to Antonis Galanopoulos, his PhD candidate. He prepared a few minutes introduction on the work of our guest. So, Antonis, the Zoom window is yours now.
Thank you, Thomas. I would like to welcome you to our event, Populism and US Presidential Election. We're very happy that we have the opportunity to be together again after our last seminar in February, even though remotely and digitally due to the COVID-19 pandemic. As Thomas said, Populism Study Circle is a student-led initiative, mainly consisting of PhD candidates and postdoc researchers working on populism and related topics. For our first online event, we are really honored to have with us Thomas Frank and our very own Yannis Stavrakakis, Professor of Political Discourse Analysis here in the School of Political Sciences at the Aristotle University of Thessaloniki. Thomas Frank is a political analyst, historian and journalist. He received a master's degree and a PhD in history from University of Chicago. Frank has authored a number of books. Two of his well-known books are clearly related to our event today. In his What's the Matter with Kansas, he traced the shift in political discourse from socioeconomic to cultural issues in order to explain how Kansas, once home to progressive movements like the People's Party, turned socially conservative during the late 20th century. In Listen Liberal, he explained the failure of the Democratic Party to address the issue of rising social inequality and its turn to a more consensual type of politics that ultimately favors the elites. There are two main reasons that led us to organize this event today. On one hand, the upcoming presidential election, and on the other hand, the latest book of Thomas Frank, The People Know, A Brief History of Anti-Populism. This fascinating book that you should definitely read. The election of Donald Trump in 2016, coupled with the Brexit referendum, affected strongly both the study of populism itself and the discourses about populism in general. In a conference paper presented by members and associates of our group, we argued that since this double shock of 2016, one can observe an explosive increase of media and academic publications about populism. But at the same time, most of them depart from an a priori anti-populist perspective. We see this development as a milestone in the history of anti-populism. But where and how this history begins? The answer is exactly where the history of populism began. In The People Know, Frank attempts successfully, in my view, to restore and defend populism as the radical progressive tradition of the United States of America. He traces the emergence of anti-populism, what he describes as a tradition of pessimism about popular sovereignty and democratic participation. He describes the abuses of the term populism, the reversing of its meaning, and shows how the classic anti-populist stereotypes of the late 19th century came back and are constantly used nowadays against populist or perceived as populist politicians and movements. In one sentence, Frank concludes, the story of populism and anti-populism is a dialectic of hope and cynicism. Without further delay, I will now give the floor, the virtual floor of our event, to our guest speaker, Thomas Frank.
Well, hello, everybody. It's me, Tom Frank. The So do you want me to start by reading from the book, or should I just give you a sort of general idea? I can do either one, and it's up to you. But maybe the thing to do is to read a very short passage from the book.
Yes, you can start in order to warm up with the book, and then...
Because the first thing I have to say is that you are the first people I have ever met who are interested in anti-populism. In fact, it's... when I was writing this book, up until the very end, I thought I had invented the word anti-populism. And then when I was, you know, getting close to being done, I dug around and I found other people who had used it before me. But I thought this was my to describe a history of anti-populism. I thought I was alone here. So this is a real honor and a treat for me that I've found other people in the world who are also interested in this. So why don't I sort of tell the story of anti-populism just here in the last few years, and then we'll go into the history side of this, okay? All right, so I'll read from the beginning, the opening part of the book, which is describing the present day. Just a few short years ago, we Americans knew what we were doing in the world. We were going to make the planet into one big likeness of ourselves. We had the experts. We knew how it was done. Our policy operatives would de-radicalize here and regime change there. Our economists would float billions to the good guys and slap sanctions on the bad. And pretty soon the whole world was going to be stately and neat, safe for debt instruments and empowerment seminars, for hors d'oeuvres in the embassy garden, and taxis you hailed with a smartphone. Democracy, of thee we sang. Now we stand chastened, humiliated, bewildered. Democracy, we tremble to think of what it might do next. Or so goes the wail of the American leadership class as they endure another year of panic over where our system is dragging them. The people, they say, are out of control. Populism is the word that comes to the lips of the respectable and the highly educated when they see the global system going haywire like this. Populism, for them, is a one-word evocation of the logic of the mob. It is the people as a great rampaging beast. What has happened, the great thinkers of Beltway and C-suite tell us, is that the common folk have declared independence from experts and along the way from reality itself. And so they, the learned, have come together to rescue civilization. Political scientists, policy advisors, economists, technologists, CEOs, joining as one, to save our social order, to save it from populism. This imaginary struggle of expert versus populist has a fundamental, almost a biblical flavor. It is a battle of order against chaos, of education against ignorance, of mind against appetite, of enlightenment against bigotry, of culture against barbarism. And so from TED Talk and red carpet, the call rings forth. Democracy must be controlled before it ruins our democratic way of life. So in attacking populism, the object, they say, is not merely to resist President Donald Trump. No. Today's political face-off is bigger than that. It pits the center against the periphery, the consensus insider against the disgruntled sorehead. And in this conflict, everyone thinks that the side of right is obvious. Ordinary people are upset. We all know that. They're all angry out in Iowa or whatever. But the ones whose well-being must concern us are the elites whom the people threaten to topple. And then I go into all sorts of hilarious examples of this, which you don't need to hear from me because you've heard it a million times, like the article in Foreign Policy Magazine, you know, Foreign Policy Magazine, that had the headline was, "It's time for the elites to rise up against the ignorant masses." And I take note of the fact that there's all of these academic conferences deploring populism, and there's even academic departments that are set up strictly to deplore populism. I mean, there's a whole industry of anti-populism these days. And they all basically agree that what populism is, it's the ism that stands for mob rule. That's what it is. It's this war against the enlightened, this war against intellectuals, this worship of the common man. Now, so what I do in the book is take this apart using history as my weapon, or as my tool, I should say. And I guess we should start with where populism starts. So the word, you know, I went back and looked up where the word itself came from, and it was coined one day in May 1891 on a train between Kansas City and Topeka. And this is especially significant for me because I'm from Kansas City, and I've driven back and forth to Topeka hundreds of times in my life. And I didn't know this before I was writing the book, but yeah, this is where the word comes from. It was made up by these guys on the train. And what they were describing, what they meant to describe with this word, were supporters of a brand new left-wing political party that had just started out in the United States. The formal name of it was the People's Party, but they knew right away that that was far too long and cumbersome for a party that had, you know, great ambitions. And so they wanted to make up a word to describe supporters of it. And they came up with the word populist. Now, and before very long, the nickname overtook the real name. And so after a while, nobody even called it the People's Party anymore. It was just called the Populist Party. And that's where the word came from. And it immediately became, the word was everywhere. It was a huge success as invented words go. The political party, the Populist Party, was also a success for a little while. This is in 1891 is when they made up the word. In November of 1890, so just a few months before, they had staged this incredible uprising, political uprising, I should say, in the state of Kansas, which has always been a one-party Republican state. It was then, and it still is today. And the populists had come out of nowhere and defeated the Republicans in elections for the state legislature. It was this enormous surprise. And then they started doing this all over the Midwest, all over the Great Plains, expanded into the South. People wanted to start up populist parties all over the place. And it was the last great third party movement in American life. It was the last time you had a third party that challenged the two major parties all up and down the ticket, all over the country, except for in the Northeast. There was very little populism in like New York or Boston or anything like that. But they were all over the West. They had a presence all over the South, et cetera. Well, to make a long story short, I mean, there's a lot of interesting parts to the populist story, but they didn't last very long. At first, it looked like they were the great in there. Okay. Can y'all hear me? So, I'm sorry about that. I don't know what happened.
We lost you just for a minute.
Okay. It looked at first like they were the great coming force in American life. This was a great moment for left-wing parties all over the world. The Labour Party was starting up in England at that time, the same in Australia. And there was a lot of back and forth between these parties. They all knew about each other and, you know, referred to each other and that sort of thing. And the unlike the Labour Party, the populists were mainly made up of farmers. They understood themselves as a as a coming together of all the working, as they would put it, working classes. They would use more 19th century terms, though. They would say the toilers or the producing classes. The idea was that farmers were coming together with industrial workers and other reform groups, and they were going to form this giant third party and basically defeat the other two parties in this way. And they did do that. They had a very famous meeting in 1892 in Omaha, Nebraska, where they formed their party nationally. They published a famous manifesto. We'll come to why a good reason why it's famous right now, because basically the world in 1892 looks a lot like the world in 2020. For a while, it looked like they were going to succeed. Oh, I should tell you what their issues were, because people don't know. Their issues were they wanted to take America off the gold standard. They wanted the government to nationalize the railroads. And they wanted all sorts of reforms for farmers, a farm program, basically, from the federal government. They also wanted various things for organized labor. They wanted the eight-hour day, which was a big deal at the time. And they wanted political reforms. So they wanted votes for women. They wanted the secret ballot. They wanted to sort of do away with lobbying. They wanted a war on lobbying. The direct election of senators. So they wanted to make it easier for people to vote, and they wanted to do away with various instruments that we have here in the United States that are supposed to mediate popular democracy. So the founding fathers of America didn't really like democracy, as you guys know. And so they came up with various institutions to make sure that the people never really were in charge. And the populists wanted to overturn those institutions, do away with them. And at first they met with great success, because the economy in America, well, all over the world, you had a depression, an economic depression, and this party was uniquely poised, a left-wing farmer labor party was uniquely poised to take advantage of public sentiment during that depression. Okay, you know, we had huge strikes in America at that time, that sort of thing. And then something really crazy happened. In 1896, you have a presidential election year, and the Republicans nominate William McKinley, very conservative, pro-gold standard. You know, he's going to stay the course. Everything is going to be exactly the same. McKinley is a high tariff man. The U.S. The tariffs were a big issue at the time. McKinley was the tariff guy. He was very similar to Donald Trump in that respect. And the Democrats meet for their convention in Chicago in 1896, and they do something crazy. They denounce the gold standard. They say, you know, this is the Democrats, one of the traditional main parties in American life. The Democrats denounce the gold standard, decide that they're not going to renominate the sitting president of the United States, Grover Cleveland. They don't want anything to do with this guy. And they nominate instead a man called William Jennings Bryan, who is a one-term congressman from Nebraska. He's 36 years old. This is the youngest presidential nominee that any major party has ever nominated in America in our history. And he's a huge opponent of the gold standard. And he's the reason the Democrats choose him is because he has just given an amazing speech denouncing the gold standard. This really extraordinary speech. It's referred to by historians as the cross of gold. Well, because he uses this metaphor, he says, "You will not crucify mankind upon a cross of gold," meaning the gold standard. And the Democrats are bowled over with his oratorical power. He is a man of destiny, and they nominate him for the presidency. And the country is absolutely shocked and horrified. And they, you know, the establishment press in the United States can't believe that this has happened. And the Populist Party, who are still going, by the way, they thought 1896 was going to be their year, But now the Democrats have stolen their main issue, which is the gold standard. The Democrats have swiped their issue, and the populists meet for their convention. And so they say, well, you know, a lot of them know William Jennings Bryan personally because he's from Nebraska. Bryan talks like a populist. He uses their kind of language. And so they say, we're going to, you know, he's not with them on these other issues. Remember, they have a whole bunch of, they want to nationalize the railroads. They want to farm programs. They want votes for women, et cetera. Bryan is not with them on these issues, but they're willing to make a compromise to try to, have some power in Washington. They think if they get behind Bryan, he will have to let them have some say in the cabinet choices, that sort of thing. And so they endorse Bryan. And, this is an apocryphal moment almost. That's not the right word. Apocalyptic. That's the word I'm looking for. Excuse me. An apocalyptic moment for the American elite. And they, you know, the world is ending. They say this is the class war. The class war has finally come to the United States. It's a French Revolution kind of situation. And they come together against William Jennings Bryan in this extraordinary way. How do I want to put this? It is a gathering of the tribes of the elite. So you have university professors, you know, leading academics of the time. You have society preachers. You have very wealthy people, millionaires, tycoons, railroad owners, you know, like the Vanderbilt family, this kind of thing, and newspaper owners, all of them come together against William Jennings Bryan in this extraordinary way, denouncing him, signing letters, you know, where you have like, you know, hundreds of economists signing a letter, or The Nation magazine talk to all of the leading university presidents in America. They were all against Bryan. There was this coming together of the elites of America against William Jennings Bryan, denouncing him in the most extraordinary terms, and the Republican Party as well, which was, McKinley himself was kind of a cipher. He didn't really say much or do anything, but his campaign manager was an extraordinary political genius, a man called Mark Hanna. He was a tycoon from Cleveland, Ohio. And he put together by some standards, if you measure what the Republicans proceeded to raise and spend as a proportion of GDP, of American GDP, it's the most expensive presidential campaign of all time. They outspent Bryan by 20 or 30 to one. And Bryan had nothing because he's perceived as leading a class war. Bryan traveled around the country by himself, buying tickets on the train, in traveling in what was called a day coach, giving speeches to people around America. And his speeches were often about the wisdom of ordinary people. And the way the Republicans attacked him and the way all of these elites came together against him is around this message that this is a campaign in which the worst elements of society are brought together against the best. So it's the best people in America against the worst. And this is the 19th century. They were very open, but what they meant by the worst. These are ne'er-do-wells, these people who are voting for the Democrats. These are fools. These are people who don't understand modern economics. They don't understand globalization. They don't understand that the gold standard is the prop, the pillar that upholds our economic order. They're going against professional economics, the learned men of our society. Besides, these people on the bottom are there because they have been chosen by nature to be at the bottom. You know, this is the heyday of social Darwinism. These are the losers in our economic order. They're also mentally ill. The New York Times published a series of articles claiming that William Jennings Bryan was in the grip of paranoia. He was clinically ill, mentally ill. It is not true, by the way, but they said it. They said that Bryanism was a form of mass hypnosis, that he had this power to hypnotize people with his voice. that, so it's anti-intellectual, it's the worst elements of society against the best, it's a form of mass hypnosis. Does any of this sound familiar to you? This is exactly the same argument. And then they came up with one word to describe Brianism. They needed a name for it. Populism. This was the word they applied to him. And this is this incredible campaign of hate fury against Brian. And by the way, so if you go to my website, if you go to tcfrank.com, I've collected a whole bunch of the political cartoons of that era and like some of the pamphlets that the Republicans were distributing all around America. And it's just incredible. And the invective that they unleashed against Brian, which is just, it's extraordinary, even by the standards of the day, was absolutely extraordinary. So needless to say, they beat Brian in this amazing campaign of anti-populism. And we'll leave that story there. What is fascinating to me and what I trace in the book is how this campaign in 1896, this anti-populist campaign in 1896, that this exact bill of attacks, this list of political insults that the ruling elite of the day came up with, get recycled from time to time. I mean, we see them very clearly in our own day, but there's one big addition to the list, which is that populists are always accused of being racists, anti-Semites, and xenophobes, which no one said in the 1890s because the ruling elite at the time was extremely xenophobic, anti-Semitic, and racist. And so they would have never thought to accuse populists of being those things. But beginning in the 1950s, and I can tell you this whole story as it develops, in the 1950s, the word populism was associated with anti-Semitism, racism, and xenophobia. Falsely, but nevertheless, convincingly for a lot of people. And that's the story that I tell in the book, how this word got hijacked from its original meaning, those guys on the train in 1891 who thought they were inventing a noble word, a word to describe a noble idealistic movement, and how it came to mean what it means in our own time. Okay, I talk too much, guys. This is a problem that I have, is that I just talk too much. And so I should shut up, and you guys have read the book. Why don't you just ask me what part of it you want me to talk about?
Yes, first we're going to have the intervention of Yannis Stavrakakis, and then we're going to pass the floor to the members of the Populism Study Circle and the audience. Yannis, it's your...
Thank you. Thank you very much. I will also, thank you very much, Tom. I will also ask you a couple of things so we can start with that. But first of all, I have to say that I am really delighted tonight to be participating in this event together with all of you. And I have admired Tom's work for many years. In fact, I think it was Chantal Mouffe that at some point I wanted to a reference on American politics, and she said to me, why don't you read Listen Liberal, which is one of Tom's earlier books. And I was flabbergasted. Yeah, it was amazing. And I have given the same advice to anybody asking me something about American politics since then. Read Thomas Frank. That's my advice. And may I add here that we have available also in Greek some of your articles published in the, they are published in the Greek edition of Mon Diplomatique. And many thanks to Valia Kaimaki for bringing this to my attention. When I saw that your last book is on anti-populism, I was really thrilled because precisely as you said, there are very few people around the globe working on this topic. There is Pierre Ostigui, who is a Quebecois Canadian working in Chile, and he has developed this sociocultural approach to populism, and he also discusses anti-populism at some length. And I am proud to say also in Thessaloniki, we have also devoted some energy to this topic within the activities of the publications of the Populismus Project. And I think there are very good reasons justifying this orientation. And I would like to point some of them. I mean, you have given some of the political reasons, some of the historical background justifying this interest and so on and so forth. But there are also very good academic reasons. And since we have mostly an academic audience tonight, I would like to point a couple of these reasons. The first one is that in terms of the material we have in front of our eyes and which is possible to analyze in the first instance, most of this material is anti-populist. This is readily available because anti-populism is everywhere, and most people, academics, journalists, politicians, are proud to be associated with it, which is not the case with populism, which is a taboo in most parts of the world, with very few politicians voluntarily endorsing populism. So from a discursive perspective, which is a perspective that we employ, it makes then more sense to start from anti-populism, because the material to which we have access in the first instance is mostly anti-populist. So this is how this is gradually emerging as a legitimate object of study on its own right. And I think it reveals a lot. It reveals a lot about our sensibilities and our take on democracy and about the way democratic reality is framed. So it is always important, for example, to realize with which other ideas or orientations, political ideas or orientations, anti-populism gets articulated, with elitism, with technocracy maybe, with Andonis. We have published an article about hierarchical abnormality stereotypes. You know, we had this idea here that Greece is not a normal country, especially during the crisis. So there is some kind of ideal of normality, and countries have to abide by this ideal. And somehow populism is one of the signs of this abnormality. So we have done this analysis of abnormality as a metaphor in public discourse, which is a very anti-populist metaphor. But I think there is also a second reason why it is very important to study anti-populism. And this is because, precisely as I said, because there is most of the newspapers, we have done an analysis of the press, both in Greece and in the UK, and most of newspapers are anti-populist. Only minority is, let's say, pro-populist or can report neutrally or even favorably in some cases something about people who are supposed to be populist. The thing is that populism is usually a designation created by an adversary. So this is very important, and it touches on something very important on a theoretical level, that we know from the beginning that there is no identity without difference. And from a discursive perspective, we go back to Saussure, for example, to semiotics, to semiology, to the foundation of modern linguistics. And it's very clear in Saussure that there is no identity without difference. We have to check. You cannot understand what the meaning of black is without contrasting it with white. You cannot understand what the word signify brother means if you don't situate it within the other words indicating some sort of a kinship and so on and so forth. So the background, the things you are up against, the things that from which we are differentiated are very important to understand what is happening in this particular landscape. And this is also something that has influenced very much Ernesto Laclau, who is one of our, from whom we draw much of our inspiration. And for Laclau, identities were exclusively relational. This is the very principle involved in the constitution of all social and political identities. So, from this point of view also, it is always very important to check and to see what, you know, in order to understand what populism is, to see how it is being constructed by its enemies, by people who are supposed to be neutral, by academics. So we have to take into account, it is not some sort of objective inquiry, you know, this is, we have this criteria, this is public. No, there is also a debate. There is also a public debate.
Okay. So one of the leading thinkers of the consensus school was a historian named Richard Hofstadter. He was at Columbia University. He was the greatest historian of that period. And was also a very popular writer in addition to being a highly respected scholar. And Hofstadter in 1955 published his sort of a very famous revisionist take on the American past. It was called The Age of Reform. And in it, it was, I think the first section of it is an attack on populism, the populist movement of the 1890s, where he basically, remember how I was talking about how the elites described populism in the 1890s? Hofstadter took all of those ideas and recast them in the sort of trendy psychological language of the 1950s. Now, he never acknowledged that he was using the same interpretation that that the Republicans had used in the 1890s, or that I should say the conservatives had used in the 1890s. Hofstadter was a liberal. It was called the liberal consensus, this period. And he never acknowledged that that's where he got these ideas. I mean, that's just something that I point out, the weird commonality between what he said and what the newspaper said about William Jennings Bryan in the 1890s. Hofstadter made like he had invented this understanding of populism, but it went right. It was the exact same list of attributes that it was, that farmers were people who didn't understand modernity. He developed ways for psychological ways for describing this, because they were people who were on their way down. They had status anxiety, was the term that he used. They were people, because they were people of, oh shit, Stefanos, what the hell's going on? is it still me? Am I still going? Or are we gonna see some more sex manuals? So, but it was the same bill of it was the same criticism that you saw in the 1890s. Farmers were people of the country, not of the city, so they couldn't understand complicated ideas. They were anti-intellectual. They were in the grip of conspiracy theories. And then he invented the other part of it. He said they were anti-Semitic and xenophobic. The famous, his essay about the paranoid style populists were in the grip of a mental disorder of paranoia. Right down the list, it's the exact same bill of critique as in the 1890s, but jazzed up with some trendy theories of the 1950s. Like, do you remember the book called The Authoritarian Personality? Theodore Adorno's book. It was a huge deal in the United States. And this is where Hofstadter draws a lot of his, I'm going to try to summarize this as best as I can, but Hofstadter is wrong about populism. His take on, before I get to that, I should say, his book was enormously influential. The Age of Reform, it won the Pulitzer Prize. It's been described as one of the most influential books of American history ever written. I think that's probably correct. It was a huge, it was extremely influential. Let's just put it that way. And within about 10 years, the American historical profession had completely destroyed his take on populism. So other American historians said, wait a second, this is not accurate. Populists were not particularly anti-Semitic, especially when you look at them in the context of society in the 1890s, populists were not particularly xenophobic. There were populists who believed in conspiracy theories, but so did everyone else at the time. That was just how people talked in politics at the time. In fact, I discovered in my own research, there are people who thought populism was a conspiracy theory, that it, that this whole movement was a conspiracy of people who owned silver mines, you know, stuff like that. And so the, within a very short amount of time, Hofstadter's take on populism was crushed. It was destroyed. It's discredited, widely discredited in American history. There's entire books written to debunk single chapters of Hofstadter's take. Here's one of them. This is a great one, by the way. It comes in the late 60s. But unlike Hofstadter's book, this is written in, this is not a bestseller. This does not win the Pulitzer Prize. This is not, you know, these attacks on Hofstadter are not widely accepted by the general public. There's people who write entire books attacking single paragraphs of Hofstadter's book. There's one about Kansas, for example, where the guy goes through local populist politicians, like populist county chairman, and says, well, were they really anti-immigrant? And the answer is no. In fact, they were immigrants themselves. Like a very large number of them were in fact immigrants. And at their annual convention, the populace would denounce the anti-immigrant movements of the time, the sort of Proud Boys of that day. The populace would attack these people. That's who they were. The book is called The Tolerant Populists. But anyhow, here's the thing. Hofstadter's take on populism, and he, by the way, he takes, like the newspapers in the 1890s, he takes the word populism and starts and says he wants to use it as a generic term for this kind of proto-fascist mentality, this authoritarian mentality. This is Hofstadter that sort of changes the word from a word that specifically refers to a movement in the 1890s to a generic term for movements that exhibit these really dreadful, traits. Okay, so Hofstadter is completely refuted in a very short amount of time, but it doesn't matter. Hofstadter's repurposing of the word populism is accepted by academia anyways. And you start seeing academics use it all over the place. Daniel Bell, this guy. The End of Ideology. This is, again, all about normals. You know, well, whenever we have books saying that, you know, politics are over, what's the Fukuyama one? What's it called? It's the end of something. I forget what. History. The End of History. That's what it is. But whenever you have people saying things like that, that, you know, we all agree in America, there's only one way to run an economy. There's only one way to run a country. And we know what it is. They describe their opponents, the people who disagree with them, as populists, these soreheads, these wrong-headed, misguided people. Why does Hofstadter's idea take root when it's based on a mistake? It's based on a mistake, and yet it is accepted, as you mentioned, Yannis, by academics and journalists all over the world. Why? Because it's very flattering to academics and to journalists. It's to them as a social cohort. It's enormously flattering to them. Hofstadter's is coming up, and all of these other writers, Daniel Bell, Edward Schills, these people are coming up at a time of managerial triumph in American life. So all of a sudden, people with MBA degrees are running corporations. Corporations are not, you know, being run by the people who own them anymore, shareholders or people who inherited them. You know, the Vanderbilt family is out of the picture. Everything is run by MBAs. The departments in Washington are being run by people with PhDs. Robert McNamara, the greatest managerial figure of his time, is running the Pentagon. This is for Daniel Bell. This is a source of great satisfaction, you know, that Robert McNamara is in charge. You know who Robert McNamara was? You guys know. This is the architect of the Vietnam War. And the promise of managerialism is that if you put these people in charge, that they can run the economy and they can deliver prosperity and they can win the Cold War against communism and they can run a modern state. And what you don't want is intervention from the lower orders. What you don't want is mass movements of working class people out in the street making their demands, okay? And so this is Hofstadter's great point. And this is why his book, his terrible take on populism still resonates for people, is because he says, that in American history, there's this one, this big conflict, and the conflict is between mass movements of uneducated people like populism or like the labor movement or like the civil rights movement, although he doesn't mention that in his book. It's between movements like that and or having people like him and his friends in charge, the managerial elite in charge. And for him, the answer is obvious. You want the managerial elite. You get the lobbyists together in Washington sitting around a big table, and they will hammer things out, and they will deliver results, and they will deliver reform. If you try to get reform through mass movements of average people, of working class people in the streets, you'll end up with pathological, conspiracy theory, racism, anti-Semitism, paranoia, madness, basically. And you see what I'm getting at here. This is a very, very old suspicion of democracy. But by the 1950s, you can't say, I don't like democracy anymore. we've just fought a world war for democracy, goddammit. We just beat the fascists, We're all about, America is all about democracy. We're engaged in a cold war with communism, in defense of democracy. You can't say you're against democracy. And so they choose a different word to describe this, this very ancient elite suspicion of democracy. And that word is populism, and they attribute to it all of the pathologies of the mob. Now, my own take on this is that Hofstadter is completely wrong, and that managerialism has pathologies of its own. That's what Listen Liberal was all about, the pathologies when you put these kind of people in charge. They do things like the global financial crisis, and then they bail each other out, and there's no consequences for Wall Street. I mean, the examples are all around us today. So in my opinion, that mass movements are the only way that you get real reform. But that's just that's a side note that Europeans probably don't care about. But anyhow, that's, in my opinion, that's why populism has caught on, because for this generation, and it's not just a generation anymore, I would say it's an entire social class, but what we call in America the professional managerial class, this class is now fully in charge in the United States. They are not only the people who rule the United States, they're the most prosperous people in the United States. This is the upper 10% of the income distribution. They are really the elite in American life. And populism is a word that they use to describe what they have displaced. And you see this especially in the Democratic Party, where there is this long-running debate between people who called themselves progressives, and this includes Bill Clinton, and people who called themselves populists, latter-day populists, which would probably, I don't know if Bernie Sanders ever called himself that, but that's his tradition, the sort of Jesse Jackson, Bernie Sanders wing of the Democratic Party. And the populists have very definitely been defeated in that long running contest. And you often, I should stop talking. We should go to some of the questions. Because I just talked too damn much.
Would you like to connect that, Tom, with the elections? I mean, you said we ended up with Sanders. What about Trump? I mean, what about Biden and Trump? Okay, the populists were defeated in the Democratic Party. What happens with the Republicans? What is your take on that?
So I do not think of Donald Trump as a populist in the tradition that I'm describing. The tradition that I'm describing, and I'll give you my definition of populism in the American context and the Americans, what it means in the United States. And it means a multiracial movement of working class people for economic democracy. So it's a left movement that tries to unite working class people from all different races and backgrounds and walks of life. And there are many examples of this in American history. Populism itself is probably is one of the big ones, but an even bigger one is the labor movement in the 1930s, which this was their exact ideology, and they were very successful. The civil rights movement in the 1960s was heading in that direction when Martin Luther King was assassinated. He spoke many times of the need to do this, to build a multiracial movement of working class people, and came up with a plan for it, talked about it all the time. And when he was murdered, this was what he was working on. This was the great idea that he had in mind. Unfortunately, since then, we've seen very little of that. But there were a whole group of thinkers and politicians even in the 1970s who called themselves populists or neo-populists who tried to build a movement like this. They didn't get very far. But Donald Trump is obviously not of that. You know, he's not part of that that sort of movement. You see what he's done as president. He cut taxes for the rich. He deregulated corporations in a really spectacular way. He deregulated his big business friends. And he, my favorite example here is, you remember how I said the populists, one of their signature issues was to take America off the gold standard. You know, this is a forgotten issue today. Donald Trump just nominated a woman to be on the Federal Reserve Board here in Washington, who wants to put America back on the gold standard, which is as unpopulist, as an issue as you could possibly come up with. And so, but there is Trump's language. Now, Trump, when he was running in 2016, and the Democrats and the liberals in America still have yet to look this phenomenon in the face, Trump did pretend to care about working class people. He said it all the time. He still talks about it today. I think that he's lost his a lot of his appeal to them in this pandemic and, you know, with the disaster in the economy right now. But in 2016, he when he talked about the bad trade agreements, he talked about the endless wars. He talked about Hillary Clinton as a pawn of Wall Street. Well, that is populist language, at least. He is at least pretending to reach out to the classic populist constituency. Now, he was always, something of a bigot, which is not part of that tradition. And you know, anybody could see that he didn't really mean it in 2016 because he was, he doesn't really know what he's talking about. But it is important to understand that one of the reasons Trump won, and if you ask me, it's the main reason that Trump won, is that he perfected a kind of fake left appeal. Now, I should take a step back here and say Trump is not the only one to do this. The Republicans have been doing this in the United States for a long time. And this is, I've written about this before. I wrote a book about it called What's the Matter with Kansas, that conservatives have perfected a phony class language. They denounce elites all the time. This is what the culture wars were about in the 70s and the 80s and the 90s. The culture wars are all about this Hollywood elite, this shadowy group that is able to control what's on your TV. Actually, it's not even a conspiracy theory. Hollywood exists. You know, the TV networks exist. This is true. And they disrespect American values. That's also true because of what they're, that's how you sell stuff. You know, that's how the advertising industry works. We all know that. But this is what the culture wars are all about, is this kind of phony class language. Ronald Reagan, for example, was very, very good at using a kind of phony populist appeal. Richard Nixon did it. What was his term? The silent majority, he would say. This goes way back. Newt Gingrich was very good at it. George W. Bush was very good at it. And there's this one character in particular who unites all of these. That's Pat Buchanan, who was one of Nixon's main advisors and was a important figure in the Reagan administration, and then ran for president wrote these people's speeches, by the way, and always talked in this kind of workerist way, but never about actual left-wing issues, always about these culture war things. And Buchanan ran for president himself as a third party candidate in, I think it was 1996. Was it 96 or was it the year 2000? I don't remember, but his slogan was America First. And Trump stole it. And Buchanan was also unique, was against the trade agreements. Trump stole that. And then Buchanan was also this bigot. You know, he was a bigot towards all of these different groups. And Trump stole that as well. So Trump, in some ways, this guy, Pat Buchanan, even more so than Steve Bannon, Pat Buchanan is the kind of great mastermind behind all of this phony populism. And Buchanan, by the way, does refer to himself as a populist. And if you go to his website, he has a picture of himself with a pitchfork. You know, he's very much he savors this comparison of himself to the 1890s. But it's quite ridiculous. You know, I mean, he has no right to it, is what I'm saying. So I think of Trump as a kind of as a phony populist, but there have been a lot of them in our you know, in American politics, and they're all over the world now. But this is something that I've written about it at great length. And the reason that phony populists succeed, this is the point that nobody gets in this country. By the way, this is a very interesting story. I used to talk about phony populism all the time, and this was Democrats love to hear that the Republicans were fake populists. Well, yeah. Why does fake populism win all the time? Because you've got nothing to challenge it with, because you've given up on this constituency. You've given up on these people who are the natural constituency of populism, which is working class people understood as working class people. Democrats don't even try with that group anymore. They understand themselves as Richard Hofstadter's party now. They're a party of, you know, the highly educated managerial elite. And that's really what they believe about themselves. And they have deliberately turned their back on these people and allowed Republicans to get away with this crazy fake, you know, message, fake workerist message. And that is, for my money, that is the entire story of American politics in the last 40 years. You know, you've got the Republicans reaching out to white working class people, and you've got the Democrats reaching out to the rich people in the suburbs. And we've just about, you know, in 2016, it's just about mission accomplished. You know, Hillary Clinton won Orange County, California, you know, rich suburban Los Angeles. This is when I was a kid. This is the most Republican place in America. Hillary Clinton won it. And Donald Trump won Pennsylvania, Ohio, Michigan, and Pennsylvania, the old manufacturing areas of America. It's just extraordinary what has happened, the reversal. But it's not populism. In some ways, it's the absence of populism that has made this possible.
So it was great all the way that you describe the scene and the antagonism in United States context, according to populism and the populism and ideologies. Maybe it's time to pass the floor to our audience in order to set their questions. We have a question for sure for the members of Populism Study Cycle, Panos Tritsimpidas, Grigoris Markou, then they can follow, and then Thomas Barros can also set his question.
Okay.
And also Reid Kleinberg has a question, at least for the beginning.
Okay.
Should I go first?
Yes, of course.
Okay, thank you, Tom, for being with us today. I hope that the hackers have lost their interest by now.
What a thing to hack, like a bunch of academics sitting around talking about books.
The internet. So in an article of yours, you write, and I quote, "Populism is America's way of expressing class antagonism." I found this statement very interesting. I think it also informs the argument of your book. And I wanted to ask you two questions on that. The first one is, how do you use class as a concept to approach populism? Because, you know, many scholars nowadays don't really take that direction. Right. So if you want to tell us you know, some things about how do you define it, do you also include, you know, the subjective side that has to do with how people actually identify themselves? And do you see populism expressing solely the demands of the working class, or is it an alliance with other classes as well? And my second question has to do with the relationship between populism and socialism. Reading your book, I had the feeling that populism was acting like a sort of synonym for socialist politics.
Yeah.
I realized that historically in America, there has been way more populist movements and politicians than, you know, socialists, you know, in comparison to Europe, for example.
Yeah.
So, you know, if you can tell us, you know, as a historian, why do you think that is? And if you consider it a positive or a negative thing? Saying this because, okay.
I'm going to have trouble keeping track of all this, but let me try.
Okay.
So first of all, so when I say populism is the American way of expressing class antagonism, I mean because Americans have never really, Marxism has never really made a lot of inroads with ordinary Americans. There's a lot of intellectuals in America who read Marx and understand Marxism, but it's never been, you know, these understand Marxist categories, et cetera, have never been popular in America. Populists would talk about Marx in their newspapers and stuff like that from time to time. So populism didn't trace itself to Marx. It traced itself to Thomas Jefferson and to Tom Paine. That's who it regarded as the sort of great thinkers in the past. And this is, so it's very all American in that sense. And this wasn't just a tactical thing. This is really who they were. Now they social class, they talked about class all the time. This is what made them so remarkable in the 1890s, that they constantly talked about class. They were obsessed with it, with the producing classes or the toilers or whatever term you want to use. This is all they talked about, because they understood farmers as, and you know, I think correctly for the time, understood farmers as members of the working class. Marx, by the way, would probably not do that. Marx would say, well, farmers own land, you know, as a lot of them did. A lot of these guys were landowners, but they weren't wealthy. These are some of the poorest, you know, people in America at the time. So there's that. It's definitely a way of talking about class, and I definitely think that you have to take class into account. Did they seek alliances? They did. I don't know how they, you know, a lot of the sort of the machinations along those lines, but they there were a lot of small business owners that were also involved in populism. But if you go back and look at the movements, the populism came out of a kind of a farmers union that was called the Farmers Alliance. And the Farmers Alliance specifically forbade lawyers. Lawyers could not be members of the Farmers Alliance. These people were hostile to the professional class. I'm going to show you something funny here. So there are very few monuments to populism. In fact, there aren't any. This is the only one I know of. It's in Kansas. It's a sculpture garden. It's what they call naive art. Do you know what I mean by that? The guy didn't go to art school. He doesn't really know what he's doing, but he wants to make sculptures anyway. And he spent the last 20 years of his life, you know, early in the 20th century, making these sculptures in Lucas, Kansas. And you can find this on the internet. It's called the Garden of Eden. Here's, again, the picture of it. What this picture shows, this is classic populism. It shows a working man being crucified. So labor is being crucified, and the four figures that are crucifying him. Do you see what it is? It's a lawyer, a doctor, a banker, and a preacher. It's the professions. It's the professional elite of the time. And the farmer who made this, he's very, you know, he lives in a small town out in literally the middle of nowhere in Kansas. You have to drive 200 miles from Kansas City to get to this place. And he was a socialist. So a lot of the populists, after populism died, it died, I left this part of the story out, but after William Jennings Bryan was defeated, the populist party fell apart, because they had made this huge compromise and then they lost, and they were at each other's throats. You know, the factions in the party were fighting with each other, and it died very quickly after that. But what was left of it, of the leadership, went into the Socialist Party, which is a brand new effort. So one of the great populist heroes was this guy, Eugene V. Debs, and he became the leader of the Socialist Party. And the great socialist newspaper in America was had been a populist paper in Kansas. It was called The Appeal to Reason. It had this enormous circulation, like hundreds of thousands. And it was a little tiny town in Kansas, had been a populist paper and became a socialist newspaper. So there was a huge overlap. By the way, Europeans always ask me that. They say, you know, why don't you just call this a socialist party? Well, because they were in all of these respects, but they didn't call themselves that. They called themselves populists. And we just, you know, we have to live with that. Is that good enough?
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
So the floor is to another Thomas, the third Thomas of our cycle, is Thomas Zygmunt de Barros. Thomas, your question.
Thank you very much, Thomas and Thomas. There are many Thomas tonight. I'd like to ask a brief question because I've been also studying, the history of the use of the term populism in both in academia and in, common language, but focusing in Brazil because I am Brazilian. Although I've been living in France. And in fact, what I always find interesting, and I think that you showed it, is that, sometimes what historians are writing tell us more about the times they are living than about history itself. I mean, than about the facts that they are describing. And you explain how Hofstadter's understanding of populism, it could fit very well in the American environment that he was living. But, well, what I've been studying about Brazil is that, in the Brazilian case, the term populism, around the same time, it started first to be used in ordinary language by politicians to refer to political dispute, and later it was formulated by academia. Later, in a couple of years later, it really had an explosion of uses, and then thinkers, academians decided to write about it. So my question is, when we talk about populism becoming a pejorative term in America and focus on Hofstadter, I always felt that we are really giving too much power for academia, let's say. Of course, you explained that Hofstadter was very popular, that, he really became apparently the mainstream. But there another political dispute happening at the same time that could explain why he decided to, to go back to populism and to explain populism again. Were, politicians using this term before Hofstadter? This is just my question. Thank you very much once again for the event and your presentation.
You got it. As far as I can tell, no, this was Hofstadter's doing, but he was, he had a much, you got to understand, he had a much greater sort of stature than most academics do nowadays. He was in routinely, wrote a column for Newsweek magazine, for example. He was as much of a public intellectual as it is possible to be. And historians in general used to have that role in American life. They still do, but it tends to be non-academic historians who write about presidents. I don't know if you guys know what I'm talking about. It's called presidential history. It's still very popular in America, but it's not, academics don't take it very seriously. But Hofstadter was a bona fide academic and also enormously popular figure. And you can chart, you can see how the word gets embraced by journalists. Now, it happens slowly. So in the 1960s, you have competing. By the way, there was another very popular historian, I should say, who disagreed with Hofstadter, a guy called C. Van Woodward, but who is a historian of the South, of the Southern United States. And he populism was big in the South. And C. Van Woodward really objected to Hofstadter's redefining of the word. And they argued with each other. They were friends too. And they argued with each other all the time. And you find in the 1960s, you have figures who are using Woodward's definition of the term, which is also my definition of it. So you have this moment where Martin Luther King, the great civil rights leader, is in 1965 gives a speech where he's at the, it's at the very end of the, and I should cut this short because I can't go for more than about 10 or 15 more minutes, but King is giving a speech in Montgomery, Alabama. It's at the very end of the Selma to Montgomery march, and it's this moment of triumph for him. And in the speech, he gives a shout out to the populists from the 1890s. It's amazing. And this is 1965. So this is Hofstadter's idea is in circulation, but King doesn't use Hofstadter's definition. He uses Woodward's the correct definition. And it's actually fascinating. He gets it clinically exactly correct. But then here's the irony. I love ironies. I'm drawn to ironies. Okay. It's like you said, Yannis, all things are defined by what they are not, right? So when King gives this speech, his arch enemy is a guy called George Wallace, the governor of Alabama. And remember those cops in Selma, the Alabama state police who beat up the protesters? That's George Wallace's thugs. And when King gives this triumphant speech on the steps of the Capitol building in Montgomery, Alabama, that's George Wallace is the governor sitting in that building. And King is basically describing himself and his movement as populists, not directly, but you can, a lot of people in the audience got that implication that that's what he was trying to say. He was talking about this great movement in the 1890s and you know, that sort of thing. Okay. 5 years later, or no, four, th- 3 years later, George Wallace runs for president as a third party candidate and makes all kinds of trouble. And what do, and he goes around the country, he's very Trumpian, you know, he's very Trumpian. And what do journalists call him? A populist. This is the term that gets applied to George Wallace. And the journalists who do this explicitly refer to Richard Hofstadter. So they say, you know, Hofstadter's definition, blah, 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 blah. It's this guy, George Wallace. He's a conspiracy theorist. He talks about elites. He's racist, you know. He believes in, you know, he's anti-intellectual. He was really anti-intellectual, by the way. He really hated college professors. And so that's where the word really gets reversed. By the way, you asked another thing, and I should just mention this because I don't want you to go away with a misunderstanding. Hofstadter did have an immediate reason to redefine the word, and that was what was McCarthyism. McCarthyism was this crazy anti-communist moment in American life in the early 1950s, where you had this real demagogue senator from Wisconsin who was also very anti-intellectual and who was accusing intellectuals and writers and university professors, basically accusing them willy-nilly of being communists. And he would accuse anyone that used big words or wore glasses of being a communist, kind of like Pol Pot, actually, if you think about it. But this guy really scared academia. And Hofstadter wrote his book as a kind of rebuttal of McCarthyism. And a lot of these guys, that's what they were writing about at the time. They were terrified of McCarthyism and they wanted a word to describe it. And the word they came up with was populism. And it was not fair. Populists didn't do things like that. They didn't lead witch hunts. You know, it's ridiculous, but that's what he was trying to describe when he came up with that.
So we'll move on with two more questions. It's the last ones, one from Ray Kleinberg and one from Anastasios Vavalis. And I think, Ray, you are ready to set your question?
Yeah, hi, thank you. Thanks for allowing me to speak, and thank you, Thomas, for the presentation. Just a quick question from an American here, but if we think about the Trump movement in the present, one thing we haven't really talked about was kind of the libertarian kind of ideology that's kind of seems to be prominent at the moment. And I'm wondering if you see kind of a populist genealogy of kind of the libertarian contingent, whether it's the Tea Party, Ruby Ridge, even going back further to a lot of the land use issues that happened with BLM and Bureau of Land Management, not Black Lives Matter, but Bureau of Land Management, and the Bundys, even going back as far as the 80s. So I'm wondering if you see that as kind of like a populist root, but from a right-wing libertarian kind of historical perspective?
Good question. So this is a subject I know a bit about, but I would start off by saying I think the libertarian moment has come and gone in American life, because Trump is, that's one thing Trump is not, is libertarian. But the Tea Party movement fascinated me at the time because it was a protest movement. It represented itself as a mass, you know, popular movement. And they used a lot of, again, workerist language, anti-elite language. However, it was almost comically anti-populist. So you remember in the populists were farmers, and one of the groups that they hated the most in American life, the group they hated the most, were commodity traders in Chicago, in what was called the pit, you know, the people who trade the grain, who make a huge profit, and farmers get nothing, but the commodity brokers do great, right? They're the middlemen who, they produce nothing, but they prosper enormously. Populists hated these people. Well, that's where the Tea Party is launched from. I mean, this is a funny detail, but the Tea Party movement is launched with a TV broadcast from the floor of the Chicago Board of Trade with a bunch of commodity brokers who are complaining because individual homeowners are about to get a bailout. Do you remember this? And they said, no, individual homeowners are who caused the financial crisis. So the whole idea of the Tea Party movement is that it's not caused by fraud on Wall Street. It's not caused by fraud by the industry, the mortgage industry. It's caused by greedy individuals. It's caused by the common people, which is a very libertarian, a sort of Ayn Rand way of, are you guys familiar with Ayn Rand, the novelist? So it's a very Ayn Rand way of looking at the world, where the people are to blame and the commodity traders they have nothing to be ashamed of, and Wall Street has nothing to be ashamed of, but it's not populist. What's funny is that they succeeded in building a kind of pseudo-populist movement on this crazy premise. I one of my claims to fame as a writer is that I went to their very first gathering. I remember it like it was yesterday. It was in Lafayette Park here in Washington, and I was a columnist for the Wall Street Journal at the time. And I wanted to go to a protest rally because it's hard times. You know, it's like the 30s. We're in the middle of this terrible recession. The economy is going down, 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 and people are going to start protesting. And somebody said, yeah, they're meeting down there at this park. You got to go. And I went, and I couldn't believe my eyes. You know, it was crazy. And I wrote about it in the paper the next day, and I laughed at them. But I'll be damned, that movement caught on. And within a very short amount of time, they had hundreds of thousands of people, and had these enormous rallies and this kind of thing. And my theory of why that happened is because, again, they were the only ones out there protesting the bailouts. Now, they were protesting them on the grounds that, remember, their slogan was "let the failures fail." And they meant by that not just the Wall Street banks, but the individuals who had borrowed their homes, who had taken out mortgages and that kind of thing. Let the failures fail. And that was powerful because there was nobody in the administration, in the Obama administration, saying anything even remotely similar. Obama had the full backing of Wall Street at the time. And it was it became, as the years went by, easier and easier to identify Obama with Wall Street. And so this right-wing protest movement, or libertarian protest movement to be exact, this libertarian protest movement was able to pass itself off as a genuine working, coming together of work. They know when I'm talking to you, and they're now they're calling me on my phone. They want to give me sex instruction on my phone. Joke, people, joke. Anyhow, they were very successful, but not really populist. Another one of my favorite examples is the novelist Ayn Rand. Her entire project in life was to reverse the populist formula. So Ayn Rand wrote her famous novel, Atlas Shrugged. And it's about a strike. It's a strike novel. So this is what I mean by the right in America longs to reverse the populist formulas, to understand, to put stand them on their head. Her novel is about a strike. It's a strike novel, one of the sort of classics populists love sort of strike fiction. In the 1930s, strike novels were all the rage. Ayn Rand writes a strike novel. Who goes on strike? The billionaires. And the whole idea is that the economy will crumble and grind to a halt if you don't have the billionaires there to run everything, because working people are too fucking stupid to like run the factories by themselves and run the railroads by themselves. You have to have the billionaires. So it looks on the surface like a populist work, but in fact, it's the exact opposite. It's like deeply, cruelly anti-populist. And the book ends with this fantasy of the billionaires hiding in a lost valley in Colorado while the world, the populist world, just burns, you know, because the people, we the people, can't run anything by ourselves. We're just too dumb. Anyhow.
Good. Thomas, do you have
we can do one more. Okay.
One more is the last one. It comes from Anastasios Vavalis. He's not among us now, but he said it to the chat. He asks if you think that the term populism is durable, flexible enough to survive this unfortunate association with Trump and Bernie's unsuccessful attempts and spread a leftist-oriented movement in the coming decade or so.
Well, that's an excellent question. And this is when I started doing the research for this, and my wife, you know, and I was, my wife could see me, you know, looking up all these articles that used the word populism in this abusive way and studying anti-populism and noticing that it had conquered. I mean, I'm still doing this. There was a conference just a few days ago where a whole bunch of political scientists, it was a conference about populism and how dreadful it is and how the common people are, you know, are too stupid to run the, you know, the usual crap. And when I started doing this research, my wife said to me, you know, the idea that you're going to single-handedly reclaim this word is ridiculous. You just can't, you're not going to be able to do it. And I like, fighting a lot for a lost cause as much as anybody else. But I think at the end of the day, she's probably right. There's no way to rescue this word. This has gone too far. And that's really unfortunate. But what I was able to do, I think, what I am able to do and what you will be able to do as well, you read this book and you'll see what I mean, is to understand that when the word is used in this incorrect way, that it brings with it a whole mythology of managerial competence and professional class competence that really needs to be investigated in its own right. And so it brings, the word is attached to a whole myth, but a myth that is, it's the myth of our time. It's the myth of Barack Obama. It's the myth of the new Democrats. It's the myth of Brussels. It's the, you know, the myth of the omnicompetent bureaucrat who can solve everything. And as we've seen in this country, and as you've seen in the European Union, they can't. They screw things up again and again and again. And then they never face any consequences for it. And so my idea was to bring that, to make that, to put that under investigation, put that in the spotlight. And so that whenever people use the word in this way, the very next question that someone asks is, yes, but there's a lot of elite failure also. Let's talk about elite failure. Let's talk about how you people screwed things up. And that's what I hope to achieve here. You know, I don't think I can rescue the word, but I can goddamn well pretty for sure complicate the conversation.
It's a very important word, the word populism, and it is not innocent. So
yes, that's right.
Thank you for your speech, for your participation, for the acceptance of our invitation. I have to thank also Yannis Stavrakakis for his intervention. Antonis Galanopoulos worked very hard for this event. Panos Tritsimpidas and Grigoris Markou also, they were the part of the team that they prepared this event. We thank you all. We thank all of the people that participated, and we hope very soon to be again here to discuss about the elections, the United States populism and populism, etc.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, people. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye, Thomas.